Hello, hello everybody. Hello everyone. I'm here again with Rita. Today we have one more episode about X-Geeks where we invite several developers, engineers who knows about a lot of stuff and bring to community to community. So hello Rita, how are you?
Hello, Otavio. I'm doing great. How are you?
I'm fine. I'm so excited to you, the new speaker today, right?
I'm
To be
excited
named.
as well. I'm excited
Like a
as well.
buzzword. Yeah.
I think people will really enjoy it, and I'm looking forward to that as well. So let's see.
Okay, that's nice. So Rita, please tell us a little bit more about X6 in 30 seconds.
Of course. So I'll do my best to fit everything in 30 seconds. But first of
Okay.
all, welcome everyone. I'm part of X-Geeks. So X-Geeks is a KI group company. So that works from Portugal and Germany. We're an engineering company focused on providing capacity to product companies that are looking for challenge-driven product engineering. And we pretty much build solutions through software. Our teams actually are currently growing, and we're hiring all sorts of engineering positions from data to mobile and also Java. So this talk is actually quite interesting. And I hope it sparks some interest in you as well. So also to let you know that if you're looking forward to work or to get to know a bit more about X-Geeks, feel free to join us or to follow us in our social media channels. We're actually going to be present at JNation, which is a conference
Oh.
happening on June 16th online. So everyone can join. So whenever you are, you can feel free to join, and we'll be there. So it will be quite cool, and I think it will be a nice opportunity for us to meet and speak more often or once more with people from the community. And yeah, if you want to know more about X-Geeks, we're around as well in our live stream. So make sure that you follow us and subscribe us, and you'll see our updates. And I think overall, this is it. And I hope you enjoy. Otavio, did I do a good job?
Wow, you did an amazing job. So if you are around, please
Thank
join
you.
us on JNation because X6 has several swags to give to you. So several amazing gifts. And one that we are working together with Payara. And yes, join us. And if you want to know about a little bit more about us, so join us in our website, so xgeeks.io, where we also have several opportunities. So thank you, Rita. But today is not about us, but about Rudy. Hello, Rudy. How are you?
Hi, Otavio. Yeah, good. Thank you.
Oh, I'm glad to be here with you. So Rudy is a Payara engineer who does a lot of amazing jobs around the globe. So he's a speaker in several conferences. He is also a contributor in several specifications, Jakarta eWorld. So he's a great. And today he will talk about Kubernetes. So it's a buzzword in our.
Yes, a buzzword,
So.
and if you have a use case for it, you can do very neat stuff with the operator. So, and I will show you a few things around how you can use it in Java. So you don't need to learn Go before you can do anything in Kubernetes, just plain Java.
Oh, nice. So please, the stage is yours, Rudy.
Okay. So, as I mentioned, I'm going to talk about a Kubernetes operator. I'm going into detail what it is, so don't be worried if you do not know it. And the good thing it is in Java. So all the things that you have learned in the last 5, 10, 20 years, you can just use it. No need to learn something new. So a few words around the Kubernetes cluster, because it is important to follow if I talk about an operator, because that operator will talk to that API server. You see in the middle, it is the backbone of the entire cluster. You talk to that API server through that kubectl tool, a command line tool that you use, but it's also used internally to connect the different nodes connected to the master, talk to the database at the etcd database, the network part of it, the DNS, the manager, and all those kind of things all talk through the API server. So that's a very important piece, and you have direct access to it. So with your operator, you can do whatever the Kubernetes Kubernetes itself does. For cloud providers, there of course are some restrictions. They shield it off, but you can make it. You can open the necessary roles so that you can create that operator. And as you will see, you can automate a few nice things with it. So at the end, I'm building it up slowly with a few examples. Beginning with just an API call to that API server. And at the end, we will have a complete Kubernetes operator. So I'm Rita de Busser. As already mentioned, I work for Payara. I'm currently in the role as product manager. So I'm responsible for making sure that the roadmap is getting implemented in the products. But also talking to clients and prospects around the product and doing talks like this around Jakarta or in general, some interesting technologies that we also support with Payara, like the Kubernetes cluster. So short overview of what we will cover today, Kubernetes overview itself and what the operator is, and then how you can use your Java knowledge to talk to that Kubernetes server and that API server. The watch principle, which is very important if you work with the internals of Kubernetes cluster. And then what a custom resource is and how you can use that, how you can use it with the operator then. So this is a definition that you can find on the Kubernetes website. And I highlighted a few words which are important in general, or especially today with the operator. Yeah, first of all, it is about containerized workloads. So yeah, containers like Docker or RunC or CRIO implementations, they all run with containers. And of course, Kubernetes works with all of those containers. So that's, of course, one requirement, but you all know that. Second thing is that it is extensible from day one. So they created everything around that API server. And it's not just an API that have some basic functionality or some standard functionality, like deploying your application within the container, creating a service and those kind of things. It is extensible, the API itself. So you can create new concepts, a new type, just like you have a deployment and a service, you can invent your new type, and you can make sure that Kubernetes can do something useful with it in your case. So that's very important, and it's a very nice thing of Kubernetes, of course. Because that allows you to do all kind of automations, automations around it. You just have to say invent something that you want to do, or you do something manually and you want to automate that. Well, it is always possible with Kubernetes as long as it is involving some containers. And it is declarative, so you don't need to program anything, of course. You have to program that operator, but to use it, it's not that you need to create a program, and you just write some YAML file. I know that there are lovers of and haters in the world of YAML, but it is a declarative way. You just define in a file how your environment, for instance, later on we will see how you can define how your Payara server environment should look like in a declarative way, and then the operator takes care of that and creates that for you. It is a buzzword, Kubernetes, so I'm feeling a bit obliged to give some down-to-earth advice also, so that not everyone is jumping on Kubernetes and Kubernetes operator, because it's a cool and hyped framework today. all those automations can lead you to a whole set of new technologies. And so you need to be aware that when you start with it, where you will end with it, and what time and money you will need to invest in it to learn it. Because if you just say, oh, I want to have my application, which is now running on-premise server, I want to have that dockerized and microservices, but then to what leads that? You have Docker containers, you have multiple containers, then you think, oh yeah, I need Kubernetes to manage all those containers. You have several deployment and services at a certain point, so that you say, yeah, I make it easier to maintain them in a group by creating some templates around it and configuration parameters. So you create Helm charts for it. And then, yeah, you have those Helm charts, but how are you going to maintain those Helm charts with different versions? Do you need to do that all manually? And then you end up with Ansible for automate those charts and so on and so forth. So that's not even the end of the series. So be aware that if you really go the way and down the road all the way, that you can end up with learning a lot of new frameworks, which can be exciting. But of course, it also has a cost that you need to learn them. You have needs to some time to do all those things properly. But back to our operator, our topic of today. Again, a definition from the website, but this time it is confusing. I have no idea what that sentence will say, method of packaging, deploying, and managing a Kubernetes application. I even didn't know that there was a specific Kubernetes application, but anyway, if you look up then the Kubernetes application, you see that it is an enterprise-ready containerized solution. Again, that does not say a lot. But see the operator as the classic plus sign operator, for instance. You have 3 + 4 equals 7. So the plus sign operator takes input variables, the 3 and the 4. In our case, the operator takes some Docker containers, takes some configuration, and based on those inputs, he creates something else. In our case, the result is 7, or at the end, as you will see with the Payara Kubernetes operator, he creates, based on a few containers and a configuration, he creates an entire Payara server environment clustered within the Kubernetes. So an operator is indeed that you write. You write it yourself, so you can define what the plus is. Java does not have it, but a lot of languages have that overloading. So you can just define, invent something, a new type of operator that takes some inputs and creates a result out of that. So then a few words around that Kubernetes API and why you don't need Go, because there are several frameworks even written in Go that are specifically designed to create those operators, but actually you don't need it. I'm not saying that those frameworks in Go are not better than the Java one, but again, that's a decision that you need to make. Do I need to learn Go and all those frameworks, or do I just use basic Java and call an HTTP-based API? Because that is the Kubernetes API server. It is just as any API, you can send a request, HTTP request to it, to the correct URL with the correct parameters, with the correct JSON format, JSON payload, for instance. And you can query and manipulate the state of the pods, the conf maps, or your custom designed and created concepts. Just as the kubectl and the kubeadm command line tools use those APIs, you can write your own program that creates and uses that API endpoints. I said you can just use that basic Java. You don't need to do anything else. So you will see that we will using just plain Java, standard Java, the public static void main for some of you probably not used anymore because we all write web-based applications, but just a standard public static void main methods will do. Of course, those API, that API, that HTTP request, it's probably easier to use one of the implementations that wrap that API within the Java classes. Because then you don't need to write all hard code, all those API endpoints. You have help in defining what the JSON needs to be, how it needs to be formatted, etc. So there are two implementations available. You have the official Java client. So that's, of course, a good one because it's always up to date. It's always aligned with that API, which is available in Kubernetes. But you also have the Fabric 8 IO client, which does also a good job. So we used it now already for more than 6 months, and we did not find any issues. And it seems to be the more popular one of the two. So that's also the one that I'm using today in the demo, and that we have used in the Payara Kubernetes operator, which I will tell you later on. How you can use it? Well, as I said, just a plain Java program. And the only thing that you need is the configuration. The program needs to know where the API's endpoints are located. They are also secure, so you need to specify the certificates and all the information to correctly connect to that API server, to those API endpoints. But by default, if you're running your Java program on a computer that has already access to your cluster with kubectl, for instance, you can just put that one line here at that new config builder build so that it uses the default config. And it uses then the same configuration as your kubectl command line, and that's enough. It knows everything. Of course, you can specify where it needs to connect and all those kind of things. I will show it to you in a moment briefly, but most of the time, just using that config builder build method here, and you have the config, and with that config, you can create a new client, a client which wraps that API endpoint. That's how you can use it. And then the Watcher program, that's like a daemon which runs in the background. But I'll tell you more when you see the demos. Not sure if there is already a question about this short introduction by someone. Okay, if you have any questions, yeah, please let them know. And at the end also, I can ask them, of course, no problem to keep them all for the end. So this is my Java program. My program, a Maven configuration where I just put the 1.8 as a version, so you can also use 1.11, of course, but just using the basics to show you that you can also use that one. And we need then to define that Kubernetes client, that Fabric 8 client, the one of the latest version is the 5.3. And later on for, especially when the operator, when we have the operator, which is running inside the Kubernetes cluster itself, we need some logging so that we so that Kubernetes can pick up that logging also to see what's going on. So I'm preparing that here already with that, with this logback version. Our standard public static void main method, as I mentioned here, that config builder. If you want to use specific configuration, you can specify the certificates, you can specify username, for instance, you can specify proxies if you need to use a proxy to access your Kubernetes cluster. You can use a namespace, you can use a specific, these all certification files. You have a lot of options there. Anything else? This is again a proxy. This is about the roles that and all kind of things. So you see, you have a lot of options to define your configuration. Here is the URL, so the endpoint of your API server. But as mentioned, it takes by default, it looks for the config that also the kubectl command, the kubectl tool uses. So in our case, that is sufficient. I have the client, and then I can just say, give me the version of the API. So if I put on the command line kubectl version, I'm accessing the same API endpoint, the same endpoint of that API server. Then I will do here with the information with the call to this method, and then I get information back that's already converted from JSON to a Java class, and I can just ask version info, the platform, the Go version that Kubernetes is using, etc., etc. So running that program, you will see that he found that the configuration here, the default configuration, so that's the one he's using then, and he says that I'm running Kubernetes 1.19, and for instance here the Git commit and etc. and the date it was built, etc. The same information that you see here at the output of the version, because we have the version that that we are requesting here from the server. But of course, we need to do something more useful. One of the useful things, of course, what we can do is listing of all the pods. You know that Kubernetes works with pods, where one or more containers are running inside, most of the time only one. So on that client, the same two lines on that client, I can call a method here called pods, and I can do here a listing of all the pods. I can also create with this method, we can create them. It's called load. So you load a file, just as you upload a YAML file to define your pod. You can also upload here one, and then that file is processed. You can delete one. Here is to delete some pods and all those kind of things. So everything what you can do with the command line tools, you can do here also with the Java. One of the things is then have a listing, and I'm not doing any additional filtering. So I'm just asking, give me all the pods that the system knows of. So that's the equivalent of the kubectl get all on the command line with the option of having it for all namespaces, because I do not do any filtering here. So again, if I run this, I get an output that there are 10 pods running in my system here for the moment. You see that the etcd is one. You have those network parts that are here. And even at the metric server, you see here also. So they are all in that namespace, the system namespace. So all that information is available, even this pod one here, that is a large object with a lot of information. You have the even the status, if the pod is running or stopped. You have all the kind of specifications. For instance, there is one of the things here is the number of containers and information what is running there in that pod, etc. So the network information like host aliases and so on and so forth. So there is a lot of information, basically all the information that Kubernetes knows about the pod is available for you here in that Java program. But polling, if you would like to see when new pods are created and or when a pod stops, etc., by just polling this this endpoint every time, then of course, yeah, that's not very efficient. We need to have something else, and that's called the watch principle. So you have watchers. And the watchers works with some kind of callback method. So you, for instance, here again with the pods, I register a listener, some kind of listener. So every time there is something happening in Kubernetes related to pods, our callback here is called. So this method here, event received, is called. So we register this this endpoint. So our program registers an endpoint within Kubernetes, and Kubernetes calls us when there is something to tell us if there is a change, and then we can see what the change is. You have an action, and the action is that there is a pod is added, modified. For instance, the IP address is assigned. It can be deleted, or the pod goes into error, and those kind of things. So that's one of the things that you receive. But again, you also receive the entire pod information of the system at that time, of the pod at that time. I'm just outputting here some information. When the system is closed, you also get a feedback on it, and the rest is just for logging purposes. So if I run this application, then you will probably see something strange, because something what you did not expect. Our watcher is registered, and we get information from Kubernetes that there is a new pod added to the system. Well, it's not actually added at the moment that we are running our program, but and that's one very nice thing I find for from this API, from Kubernetes itself. At the moment that we register our watcher, Kubernetes sends us the entire status of the system as it is at that moment, send it to us as an event. So for our, it's not an operator already, because that's in a moment, but for our program, it's a new pod, because before our program started, he did not know anything about that pod. So it is a new pod. So Kubernetes sends us the information as if it was a new one, and he sends us the information for this pod, for instance. And then we have for each pod there an entry. So again, for 10 of them. So if we then add a certain pod, so for instance, we apply some deployment. That's I can show it to you. It's nothing special, just APR, a micro instance that starts up. I can apply that, and immediately you see that there is a new added entry for that Payara micro one. And if you look at the name here, so we say kubectl get all, see that there is one pod ending with dw8, the same one that we received here. This is only a name, so the internal unique ID is this one, and there is a version. And that version is important, because as you know, with events, events are thrown, let's say thrown by Kubernetes, and we are, as listener, we receive them. But actually, there is no guarantee, like in many event systems, no guarantee that the events arrive in the same order than they were submitted. So we get here a modified version, and as you remember, we have the entire actual state of the pod so that we can base our program on that. But how do we know that this one, this modified, this event is indeed the latest at that moment? Because you see, a few milliseconds later, we receive another one. But is this second one submitted later than the first one? That version tells us that information. So each time an event is thrown by Kubernetes, it is assigned a unique number. It's called a version number, but it's not actually a version number of that pod. It is just a unique sequence number that increases. So by comparing those numbers, you can see this is 77 and this is 73. So this means that this second event was submitted later than the previous one. And that information in this pod parameter is more recent than the one we had before. So if you are using this callback method, based on this version number, you can decide if you are receiving the latest version or that you received an older event and that you should discard it because you probably are not interested in it anymore. So you see there are several different modified events. First of all, the pod is created in a state, in a create state or something, then the Docker container is loaded, and also all those different stages are happening. And this is, for the moment, the last known version. Again, if you then delete that deployment, ctl apply, no, not apply, delete this time, and you see, now and then a new event appears, so it's a continuous stream for whatever the system is doing internally. So I delete that deployment at first, that the state again is probably changed, and then after some while, the pod is actually deleted, and you will see here the delete event appearing. So this watcher is the start of our operator. It's not really an operator, and I will tell you the reason why. But as you see, it is a program which is constantly running. As I said, it is some kind of daemon program, something running in the background, which is always there because we have registered ourselves within the Kubernetes system. Any questions on this for the moment? Because this is one crucial point, this event mechanism and that resource version.
Hello, everybody. There's a time to do questions. So there's no further questions. So go ahead.
OK. Then we come actually to the point where we're going to write a operator. And as I mentioned before, an operator takes several input parameters. 3 plus 4, our operator takes 3 and takes 4. So our operator could, and this was my very initial version, I called it 0.1 of the Payara operator. So it does not do a lot, but I will show you in a moment. But one of the parameters that it takes, the input that it takes, is this kind of YAML file. It's called a custom resource document, or CRD. It looks a bit familiar for those who knows Kubernetes. It looks a bit like a deployment or a service. You have a kind metadata and a specification. But this, of course, is something that I have invented. I can invent any kind of thing, saying, oh, I need to use this Payara image as option, as parameter. I have this application property, and I have this instances property. Before, of course, Kubernetes can do anything with this, because if you just apply this to the Kubernetes, it will say, well, I have no idea what you mean, Payara.fish, what the hell is that? I'm not familiar with it. So you need to tell Kubernetes that you will supply him later on a document with this namespace. I call it a namespace because I'm from a Java world. So probably it's not the correct name in Kubernetes terms, but you have this namespace at the Payara.fish kind of domain with these properties. So first thing you need to do is, and it's also a CRD, but this time it is a custom resource definition. You define that namespace. A namespace, you can give the version, so because you can have an alpha version, beta version, v1, v2, etc. Just as in normal API. Resource versioning, so you can have multiple at the same time. You can specify different versions, and you also specify which properties there are allowed within that spec one. You can even change that spec one. That's okay, probably not useful because almost everyone knows what spec here means. So it's probably good that you keep that one. But then you can say, oh, I have a property Payara image, property application, and an instance, which is in this case an integer. This is a document that Kubernetes knows about, because you see that is in the namespace, let's call it like that, in the namespace that is from Kubernetes itself. So this is a structure that it knows and it can do something with it, namely knowing that you will submit later on documents with that type of information which is specified here. You can do here also validations, you can set default values, the normal classic things that you can do, you can also define them here. That's the Kubernetes part. So I can say Kubernetes CTL apply. It's not doing autocomplete. So it is called define, I think, define. Okay, I already did it this afternoon and I tried it out again. So it is unchanged. So I have uploaded this definition and now he knows about it. If I'm correctly, get CRD. You see, this is the one that we have uploaded today. This is one from the official Payara operator, but this one, you see the day is today. So that's the one that I uploaded today, which corresponds with this one. So he knows now about it. He knows about this namespace. Our client, Fabric 8, does not know it yet. So that's the next step that we need to do. We have a POJO where we define values for the three properties. And we only need getters because we always receive that information from Kubernetes. And then we need to define a class which extends that custom resource where we supply that POJO clause, and where we define here that information about that namespace and the versioning. I've put here a toString because I can put it then later on as an output, but other than that, it does not do anything. And since Kubernetes can have a list of all those things, you also need to create a list thing. We just say, create a list of this other resource. And now we have a real operator because this program, again, still our public static void main with the same config builder, etc. But now it will run later on inside our Kubernetes cluster. So it will be running always. So it's not that it's running on our machine as before. And then if we stop it, then yeah, of course, it doesn't do anything anymore. Now we will put it inside the cluster. And then, of course, we have a real operator because it becomes part of Kubernetes. First check that I do here is list all the CRD documents, the definition documents, to see if there is something with that name. Because if it's not already created, then our operator cannot do a lot. So then throw an exception, and the program stops. And second thing is that I, for the client, I need to register that we have something with that domain. So I give here the domain and the that resource class as parameter. So then the system knows enough. This needs to be a constant because it used at two places, but it was my first version. And then again, all this code is on the GitHub account, so you can look at it later. Again, we can define that watch, a watcher which looks out for that custom Payara domain resource that we have created. So every time we do a kubectl apply, then this method is called. And again, we check if we have the latest versions. If not, we do nothing. And that was the beginning of the actual work. We accept that event. And the only thing that it does is putting something in the log, because then I know that the entire integration between Kubernetes and our operator worked. And I put here also in the log the two strings, so I know and I check if then the information that I put in the YAML, that it is received correctly here by this program. I have a Docker file, because I'm going to deploy it within Kubernetes. But again, just the basic JDK 8 Alpine one, where that Payara operator is copied into the image and is executed with Java minus jar file. And then, of course, I have a YAML file where I specify that that image that I've created is running as a deployment. So I have that one. So I can kubectl apply. It's the Payara operator YAML. And he's saying me kindly that I missed the minus F. It is created. So I can show it you that there is now a deployment Payara operator running, and means that there is a pod running within where that our program is now running. So it does all give already some information. For instance, within the log, we see that something that I've put there, our Payara operator test is running. It's specifying in which namespace it is running. So that's here the first line in the output in the beginning in the main. Here I get the namespace, and then I print it out somewhere. But our watcher does not see anything yet, so it's not called yet. So remember, we started with this one, where we specified the parameters. And then we can say kubectl apply minus F Payara main resource YAML. It is created. As I said, our operator does not do anything except putting something in the logs. And as you can see, the log says now that he has received a POJO with this information. So the name is example, the metadata, that's the version, and the spec values at the Payara image, the application, and the instances here is too. So that is our first success in our Java operator that we have written, so that we can make an integration with it with Kubernetes. Once you have this, the rest is just executing the commands that you like. You can, as I showed you, you can create new pods, you can create new services, you can even call batch commands, batch ops, batch command line tools from your container which are there. So all the things that you normally do by hand, by applying and by starting up a SSH within your container and then performing some commands, etc., all those things can now be automated through that operator. And that is exactly what we have done for the Payara operator for Kubernetes. And why do you need a Payara operator? So that's one thing. So clustering is already done automatically within Payara, within Payara server and within Payara micro. That's, you don't need to do anything. So if you have several pods in the same replica set, for instance, they cluster automatically. If you put Payara micro instances here, they share the same domain data grid, meaning that if you put something in the cache through JCache, then that's immediately visible. HTTP sessions are synchronized, etc. So that's perfect. Payara micro is a Jakarta web profile. So if you need the full profile, you need to go to this Payara server. You can put here a domain server, so three different domain servers in each pod, and that works also at domain data grid with one change, one configuration change, also see each other and then can also cluster, but only the data, so only the JCache, not the HTTP session. Therefore, you need the deployment group. And with the deployment group, it is a bit more work, of course, because you have a domain server, which is one type of container. You have those instances which need to be correctly set up in a deployment, what we call a deployment group for the cluster. So if you do it manually, setting up this takes around 7 or 8 commands that you need to do. So that's why we created the operator. The same principle, you have that CRD file where you specify these are the container images. These are my number, two instances, for instance, and he creates for you all the necessary pods. He configures the deployment group. He executes the necessary configuration within the domain server, like connecting to your database, etc. All those things are done by that operator based on the information that you put in that CRD document. That's it. That was the story of how we created our operator in Java for Payara server. So any questions?
Oh, sorry, my connection here. So thank you, Rudy. Okay, let's stop share screen now. That was a good one presentation. Everybody, that's time to do questions, to fire your question. If you have any question, doubts, that's time to talk. But anyway, I will call more time to learn more about Java and Kubernetes operators. Thank you, Rudy, to share your knowledge with us.
Okay, yeah. So, the presentation is, I can maybe share the links later on. The presentation itself is available, and I can also put a link to the GitHub repo with those examples.
Okay. So thank you, Rudy. Thank everybody to watching us. And I will put the slides and the code in the description.
Okay. Thank you. Enjoy the evening or the day wherever you are.